Good morning, everyone, and welcome to the keynote opening session of day two of the Python Web Conference. I'm really excited to have a developer advocate from IBM with us here today. Damien is going to be talking about making sense of measures, and I'm really excited to hear about that, especially in the context of everything we're talking about right now. So Damien, I will let you take it away. I'll be sitting here off to the side. If you need anything, just holler, but please.
So let's get into it. We got 45 minutes and I've got a lot to tell. So I usually say, if you want me here to talking about this stuff, it's somewhere in between 3 minutes and 3 days. So let's try to do it in 3/4 of an hour. So today about making sense of measures. So we're talking about COVID measures in this case. So I took that as an example to show what you see as you, as a data scientist, start using Python and just open up a data set and try to make sense of it. That's basically what it's going to be about in this coming 3/4. A little bit about my relationship to Python. I hope that most of you know more about Python than I do, because I've only been really diving into Python for, let's say, 1 or 2 years now. So I used to do a lot of work with SPSS at IBM. Maybe you don't know, but a couple of years ago, IBM acquired SPSS. So I did a lot of the data science work with that, with tooling. Started a little bit into scripting after that. And nowadays, my work as a developer advocate is mostly with open source. So about a year ago, when IBM told us to start working from home and to keep apart from each other, keep our distance, I decided that I needed some new material for doing workshops like this. Usually they're a bit more practical and hands-on. So I'm just showing you stuff today, but you can try to go along, but probably pick the stuff up afterwards if you like to. So about a year ago, I was looking for new material and I decided to dive into the COVID data. My wife, who is a nurse, was starting to get really busy at our local hospital in full isolation, treating COVID patients. And I was just sitting there and thinking, can I also contribute a little bit to at least the understanding of how this stuff works? So that's why I dived in. About a year ago, I really produced a lot of material in that year, did a lot of workshops. So I'm just going to give you a little bit of an overview today and a bit of a feeling of where to start when you really want to dive into data using Python, using the usual stuff like Jupyter notebooks, the usual libraries like Pandas, NumPy, and what have you. You'll see all that stuff. But I'll try to present it as, how does that stuff look for an experienced data scientist, which I can say about myself. I've been doing this for over 25 years now. What you see as an experienced data scientist when you really start using this material. So everything you see today is freely available. It's all on my GitLab pages. So if you just go to github.com/Dezwietering, we'll share the link with you. There's this Corona repository, and you can find anything I talk about today and a lot more in that area. It's all freely available, so it's all open sourced. Somebody told me to put an MIT license on it, but that's just because, I'm supposed to do that, I guess. So it's free for you to use, as long as you tell that you got it from me. And it's all based on open data as well, which is pretty important, because that means that you can just download all these scripts, all that code, and start running it for yourself. So most of the code will download its own data from open repositories that are available all over the world. So you can basically just pick this up and start running it for yourself and extend upon it. So it's all about Corona data. So the first thing last year was looking for data. So where do you get my data? I started off with using the EU CDC data set, which is from the European Center for Disease Control, one of the first data repositories where they had daily figures about Corona outbreaks, about positive tests in the world, worldwide. And I decided to start at that point because I really first wanted to understand, how does this work? What does an outbreak look like? How do you how is that data formatted? How can you compare regions to each other? And the trick there, I could have started really diving into only the Dutch data, because I am from the Netherlands, presenting from the Netherlands right now here. So it's I'm already after lunch, honestly. We really want to understand, what does an outbreak look like? You need data from separate countries, from separate regions, where the circumstances are very different. Because that means when you find out something that is more or less the same, let's say between South Africa and Iceland and Japan, it's probably some kind of ground truth. And if you only look at one country, you only look at one circumstance, and you only learn about that country, but that knowledge is not very well generalizable. So if you learn something about the Netherlands, you can hardly say anything about how stuff will proceed in Japan, for example. While if you find something that is the same between the Netherlands and Japan and Brazil and whatever, you can probably also say something sensible about stuff happening in Iceland. Let's put it that way. So look broad at your data, but that also means that you can only use data, a data set where you have data, where you have the same data for all those countries. So very detailed information about the number of people hospitalized and everything is just not available over all countries, especially not in the beginning, last year, April or May, when I really started digging in seriously. So you need also a data set. The width of the data set is a bit constricted by what you have available for all those countries. But okay, UCDC already had a quite a nice data set. So let's just look at what I found and run a little bit through it and do some more advanced modeling later on. Most of my notebooks available, they just do a wget to download their own data. So you can just run the notebook and it will look for new data, minus N. And if there's new data, it will download it and start using the data. So what I do here is I just do the daily Excel sheet from the EUCDC. And then you may ask, why Excel? Weren't you talking about open data and everything? I found out in the first couple of weeks when this data was available that the CSV file available there was corrupt sometimes. There were commas at the wrong places. It was suddenly semicolons instead of commas. So I decided that the Excel sheet was a little bit more reliable to use, and I've kept using it for a certain period. So what's in that file? Very simple. There's just records in there about a country and a date and the number of new infections, new cases and deaths for that country. So every row is just a date. So this is the data for 14th of December for Afghanistan. They had 746 cases and 6 deaths. So that's basically the only data that I will be using in the beginning. So in the beginning, I was just only looking at how does this outbreak proceed? So what does the curve look like, you might say? So basically only 3 columns, which means that I could use data from just all over the world. If they had these 3 columns, a date, a region, and a number, I could start my analysis on that. So that's talking about using the minimum amount of data to start with, at least. Now, there's always nice stuff going on the first time you look at the data set. For example, these countries are all coded by GeoID in this case, which is a two-letter code for the country. And I started missing data right from the beginning. And I spent almost 1 or 2 hours looking at what was going wrong, downloading these files, looking at the CSVs, looking at the Excels. And that was the typical thing that you always have when you start importing new data, is that one of the countries in there was Namibia. And you can guess the two-letter code for Namibia, which is NA. And then you can also guess by default, what read Excel, the pandas function for reading Excel files, will do with a value of NA. It will assume that it's not available. So I got empty cells. That's basically what happened. And that's typical. And it also shows you that you always have to check and double check and check again. So that's what I do most of the time. So there's a lot of code in these notebooks that basically, for if you're looking at the first time, does 2 or 3 times the same thing in different ways, just to see if the same thing comes out, just to check if all my assumptions are correct about this data. So this is one example, Namibia, NA, not available. So that I already had to specify that I did not want default NA handling and stuff like that, which always happens. Just some checks on the data here. I've got almost 62,000 records here in this data set. I can see there's a little bit of data missing for some countries, which is the territory code and the population data, which is not available for all the countries. But okay, the numbers that I need, like the date reported, the cases and the GeoID are available for our countries in this data set. So this is just a check to see if that stuff happens. Which is just a matter of doing some method on the data frame that I just read, just a count of records. And then this is one of those checks. just a check to be very sure that I don't miss any GeoIDs. So just show me all the GeoIDs that are missing, that are not available. And I got an empty result, so okay, I'm fine now. You see a lot of those checks, and if you start working with unknown data, always check and double check and triple check these kind of things. So there's no data missing, basically. That's what I made sure of. I've got this long, what I always call this long, narrow data set, which has for one date, for one country, one number, but that's not very nice to analyze. So I wanted to switch this stuff to columns, data with cases per country in the columns and dates in the rows. So I get a data structure that's a little bit easier to analyze. There's a pivot statement available in Pandas, so you can easily pivot your data around, just like you may have done in Excel, for example. So you get this kind of format. So basically, I converted the data set to this format, and that's always something to spend quite some time on, to be honest. If you start analyzing data, first get it in a format where you can easily analyze it. Otherwise, all your queries on the original data set could also have delivered everything that I will show you, but it would have been much more complex queries. So if you first get your data into a format where you can easily analyze, it just saves you a lot of time. So think about the data format that you want to use for analysis. I chose this one. I've got two big slices in here, one with all the case data and one with all the death data. The GeoIDs are in the columns, so the countries are columns now, and it's ordered by date, so every row is a date. So it's now very easy to see that, for example, AT, which is Austria, a country in Europe, Austria reported on the last date of last year, they reported zero cases. This is what this number says. And you can already see differences. So for example, you can see that Austria was already reporting, but they reported zero. But this one, which is Argentina, South America, they did not report any data for that date. So there's already a difference. So some countries were already starting to report and they said, okay, we have zero cases. And there's a lot of other countries who weren't reporting yet. So you can already start seeing differences here in this data set. Right, so now I've got something that I can analyze. So it's very easy from this data setup to start drawing plots, for example. So if you just say, okay, I want from my data frame, which is now called DFGeo, it's pivoted by Geo, I want the cases slice, and I want the Netherlands figures, and I want a plot of that. That's just as easy. Just type in this command, and you'll get the default plot, which is a line plot, nothing special, but you can already see how the cases progressed in the Netherlands. So you first set up an environment where you can very easily start asking questions to your data, like how did the cases progress in the Netherlands? Which then, if you got your data in the right format, is as easy as just show me the cases for the Netherlands and plot them for me. So this is one of the first results. You can already see some effects here, like this ripple effect here. Just as easy, you can do the death data for the deceased in the Netherlands. And here, this effect is much stronger. So you can already start asking questions about your data, about the process through which the data came to you, which is always something to take into account. You never see the actual data or the actual measures that were in the field. There's always a process that all this data comes through before it comes onto your desk. So now you can start asking questions and saying, hey, what is this sawtooth effect in this data here? Well, for example, so then you dive in, you start talking to experts, people that are processing this data, and there's a very strong weekly reporting effect here that you see. And that is just an administrative effect where you see that, for example, people who die over the weekend are mostly reported on Tuesdays. So this is what you see. So all these peaks are Tuesdays and sometimes Wednesdays when there's a bank holiday on the Monday, then they're reported even later. So that is the effect that you see. So this is not the actual data. This is the data that already went through this process. So you try to understand what was going on. And this already means that you have to do some smoothing on the data. Because if you start predicting on this kind of data, the very simple model will tell you that next Tuesday, the number of deceased will be higher than on next Monday, which is always the case. So a very simple model will easily find that out, but that doesn't tell you much. So you have to correct for that. So you start digging into the data set and start displaying all these kind of different plots. There's other effects as well. This is just one of the examples also that you run into. Here we're looking at the data for China. Cases for China is specified here. And the very simple effect that you see here is that on a certain date, they found out that in their database where they registered positive tests, they had about, well, let's say 14,000 records, which did not have a date. So they had to make a decision. What do we do with these people? Because we need to register them. We need to report them. So they decided to put all these people on one date. And that's, some of the things that you see in this kind of data, which you will also see if you go into corporate data or any data that you start on as a data scientist. There's always these kind of weird stuff going on, which you start asking questions about to the people that provide these data. So I dived into the news and found out that this was the case, and they just reported all these cases on one date. So here you see a nice curve, nice outbreak-like curve, the typical outbreak that you always see, and there's this weird peak here. And then as a data scientist, with the people that are actually going to use your results in the end, you have to start discussing about, what am I going to do with this? Am I going to leave in this peak? Because it's something that was reported. But then when I do my analysis, I have to tell you, I'm not going to tell you what actually happened. I'm going to tell you what was reported. So if they want to know what actually happened, you have to, separate up this peak over the month before or something, or over the week before. You have to maybe average it out or take it out. But you have to be very specific about that, because if you simply take it out, then you will have a nice curve, but then your totals don't add up anymore. You will miss 14,000 cases. So there's always a lot of assumptions going on if you start looking at these data and making choices about how to progress with this kind of, let's say, dirty data. And there's no one answer to that. I mean, it just simply depends on the circumstances and what you want to report about. If you want to report about the quality of the reporting process, then you leave it in. If you just want to see how this case, how this progressed and what the mathematical function behind this curve would be, you would probably leave it out. But you document that, and you be very specific about that kind of assumptions. That's a little bit of encountering measures. So that's going in the direction of making sense of it. But for now, we're just making sense of what we're looking at. What is actually what we're seeing here? And you always have to keep in mind, you're looking at the results of the process. And then something that I also always do when I see one of these weird peaks in the data, and I have already processed the data myself, it might be my error. So always doubt yourself, I would say, and see if you actually correctly process this data so that this graph came out. It might also be your process. I have done a couple of Python statements on this data in the notebook before, so it might be my error. So then I check back to the original data set if I can find this the original data that actually led to this peak. So that's what I do here. I check if there's any days for China in the original data set where the number is above 2500, just to see if there's days actually where that did happen. I get this list and I see there's actually a date, 13th of February, and I found that date in the news as well. So I could double check if that was correct. They actually reported 15,141 cases. So this is the original data set, unprocessed data set. And I found out that this peak is actually there. And that's also something that you keep doing and that you must keep doing if you see something weird. It could be the original data. It could be the process through which it came to your desk. But it could also have happened on your desk. It could have been you that made the mistake. So always double check before you start Twittering it or whatever, or going to the press and saying, whoa, I've got this effect here and what's going on. And then a month later, you have to say, I'm sorry, I just made a calculation error here, which happened a couple of times. I mean, I am in a more or less small forum where we exchange these kind of numbers. And there has been a couple of times last year where I reported something there and had to come back later and say, sorry, that was my mistake. Didn't really happen. So always check that. That's just a little bit of an introduction of what you encounter when you start using this kind of data. So there's lots more to tell about that. So then you can do all those graphs, but I invite you to pick up this notebook for yourself. It's very easy. You can simply run it in a Jupyter notebook environment. I've got instructions in the README here as well, If you want to run it in a ready to run environment in IBM Cloud, if you want to, there's lots of pointers here. But for the rest of this session, we will look at data that's here in this folder, the PyData folder, which is pointed to from the top README. And there is a lot of workshop material in there. So there you find all the stuff that I'm going to show you now, which is, well, at least for me, pretty well documented. Can always get better, but there's a lot of information there. And I'll just scroll a little bit through it to see what's going on. There's links there, there's background information. So you can really pick this up if you go to the PyData folder, pick this up for yourself and start analyzing if you're interested. Halfway something happened that also is usual when I start using data for seriously in just about all of my projects, is that on the 14th of December last year, EUCDC decided to stop publishing daily data. So I had to switch to another data source, which is annoying on the one hand. On the other side, it's also a good test to see if you set up your data analysis a little bit flexible. So if it's how hard it is to plug in a different data source. So I switched to the data from Our World in Data, which is a much wider data set. This is just some of the same graphs that come from there. And here you can see that there's a lot more information in there than just about cases and deaths. There's also stuff in there like patients in intensive care, relative numbers per million, tests, but there's also a lot of health information in there, like how many people were vaccinated in the country, how stringent were the measures at that point, how is what does the population look like, what is the median age, stuff like that. So there's a lot of extra interesting information in that data that you can use to build analyses on. So that's just a hint. Have a look at the data from Our World in Data, which is much richer and it's published daily. It's a little bit behind. So always in my morning, which is your late night, I guess, the new data is published. So I get the data from the day before for me in the early morning and start processing it. Right. To go a little bit further, I wanted to make sense of what does an outbreak look like. So every outbreak that I looked at, so here we're looking at the Netherlands, for example. When I look at US, if I just run the plot for the US, you can also see there's these bulges, there's these similar shapes in that in all the outbreak data. So if I take the UK, for example, you can also see this first outbreak, which rises steeply, then goes down a little bit more slowly. Then we have another steep rise again. So they are looking similar. So I spent quite a lot of time and quite some discussion with epidemiologists, virologists, to make sense of what is this, what does an outbreak look like? And discussing all that, we came to a certain distribution, a little bit of the science in data science, you might say, which has the kind of shape that you usually encounter when you look at a full outbreak from beginning to end under more or less constant circumstances. That is a big assumption that you take, that the circumstances for that outbreak are more or less constant. Then they all look like this, basically. So they're all based on a kind of mathematical distribution, probability distribution, that progresses in this way. So you can also always see there's a steep rise and a long tail. That's basically how we call that in statistics. There's a function there as well. So it's based on a mathematical function with a lot of exponentials and a lot of logarithms to encounter. So I actually dived quite deep into my high school mathematics again to make sense of all this stuff. But basically what I did is I tried to fit this kind of function to the outbreaks that I saw, because then you have a kind of description of the outbreak and you can start calculating about it. That's what happened in this notebook, which is called the Gumball Pivot Notebook. And I'll take you a little bit through that process. So basically here you see the outbreak for the data for the first main outbreak in the Netherlands in this case. So here you see more or less this function, which is not that smooth usually, because there's a lot of noise and you have this reporting effect. I already took out this reporting effect by taking a rolling 7 window over the data. So I always take the average of the week before today. So you take out these all these peaks during the week. So there's always, if you take 1 week and you have a weekly effect, there's always one peak in the window that you're looking at. So you're smoothing your data to make the analysis a bit more reliable. So that's what you see here. So it's a bit more smooth and it looks like this kind of distribution that you saw. And then there's just a lot of mathematics going on. I won't go through all of that. So feel free to have a good look at what's going on there. What I basically do is I calculate from this distribution. I say, okay, if this distribution is valid for this kind of data, how can I reduce that to a linear relationship? Because then when I turn it around, if I have a linear relationship, it's very easy to model the data because you only have to fit a line on it. There's quite some stuff going on, some optimization going on here. So here there's a big optimization function that I wrote that gets called repeatedly to see if I have a good fit to the data. There's the optimization going on here. So you see that there's a function calling this optimization function repeatedly to find the best fit to this function. I won't go into all the details because that will be a bit too much. So feel free to have this discussion with me afterwards in the chat. Basically what it does, it finds the best fitting area to fit a line to. And that is what's going on here. You see the blue data is the original data, but then reduced to a line using the mathematics that I talked about. And the orange one is the fitted data. So I can actually see that the Dutch data for the first wave in this case very well follows this function, because if I do all this mathematics and I can draw a straight line over the data, then it fits pretty well. So now I've got a description of the data in a mathematical formula. That's basically what happened here. And that's basically what you do most of the time in data science, to be honest. You try to make a kind of summary of your data, which you can describe with just a couple of parameters, just a couple of numbers that will describe your whole data set. Because that means if you're able to do that and you only got a part of the outbreak, which was what I was looking for, and you can say, okay, I've got this part of the outbreak, but I can describe that, then you can calculate how it will progress. That's basically what I'm trying to do here. So it's a little bit of prediction going on here and saying, okay, if I got the start of an outbreak and I can fit a line to that, I can predict how this outbreak in these circumstances will progress. That's what I'm trying to do here. So I've got this line, and then I can calculate that back doing all the reverse mathematics that I did to create this line. And then this comes out of it. So here you've got the cumulative, and I'll just show you the outbreak data. So this is the result of that first analysis. The blue is the original raw data for the Netherlands with this weekly reporting effect in it. You can see it going on here. The orange one is the smooth one, which you just saw in the smaller picture as well. So the orange is smooth data where I eventually fitted on. And the green one is my formula. So this is basically the result of fitting my formula to the data. And you can see there's lots of statistics and lots of measures that you can use to find out how well it fits. But believe me, it fits pretty well due to the first part of this distribution. So you can see it follows the rise, it follows the slope down. There's a little bit of a reporting effect here, basically. And you can see that afterwards, where my green line goes down all the way, because it just describes this first main outbreak, you can see stuff happening afterwards. And these are just already secondary outbreaks and stuff that is happening after this first main outbreak. This works for quite some countries. So if I just plug in the US, for example, let's just see how that works. I have to go a little bit up here, and I'll just start with US here and run all the cells below to calculate that for the US. Here is the result for the US. So here you can see that it fits the first outbreak, basically what happened in New York, which is this main stuff here. And you can see that the New York outbreak, which is modeled in the beginning, it was just New York in the US. You can see that it follows quite well and then it starts going down again, but this is just the New York part. And the stuff that happens afterwards here, where I don't have a very good fit, is actually stuff happening outside. So you can see the first wave is very well fitted here, but stuff is happening afterwards. And if we have the time, I can show you a little bit of how I started dealing with that. But for now, we'll just concentrate on this first outbreak. You can do this for any country. So you can just start plugging in countries and having a look at how to describe this first outbreak, how to understand what actually happened, and start calculating derived stuff from that. And one of the things I wanted to derive from this is a kind of severity measure for this first outbreak in a country. So how hard was the country hit by this first outbreak? And one of the measures you can use for that, there's lots of them, but one of the measures that you can use for that is how many people were at the peak of the outbreak. So for the US in this case, on this day, somewhere late May, how many people were infectious at that moment? And the way to look at that is that you take the peak here and you look for about 10 to 14 days around the peak about to the number of people that were actually infected there, because these people are probably infectious. You are infectious for maybe around 10 days after you get infected. So if you want a number that shows you how heavy is the load on the healthcare system, a very good measure is the number of people that are infectious. And you can calculate that from this curve. Because a percentage of those people will end up in hospital, and another smaller percentage will actually end up in ICU, and they are the big load on the healthcare system. So how hard is a country hit? The amount of people infectious at the top of the curve, which is something you can calculate. So I did a lot of derivations here. So for the US, that number would be, so this is the peak date for the US for the first outbreak, April 22. This outbreak ended in August, but that was the New York outbreak. And there's some stuff derived here, which shows you how fast it was rising at some point and what date it rose the fastest. And this is the maximum reported. So here you can actually see, I take this data set, I take my predicted measure for the country, and I do a rolling 14 window over that, which I then summarize. So I do the sum over the 14 days before any date that I'm looking at, and I take the maximum of that, which is the maximum caseload for that country. So basically that's the way that you calculate stuff like that. And that is for the US, first outbreak, how many people at the same time were infectious, is 485,000 people, which is pretty, which is a large amount. So at one point during the New York outbreak, almost 500,000 people were infectious at the same time, which is quite a lot. But then again, maybe not that much if you compare it to the total number of people in the US. So that's always a choice that you have to make as well. Am I going to just compare this to the area that these people were infectious in, or am I going to take this on a by country number? I wanted to have a look at the severity per country, so I took the by country number. So what happened? I just ran this for all countries in my data set, which is this multiple notebook here, which basically contains the same code, but just in a one big loop that says for country in countries, because I've got all these countries in my data set. So I just run the analysis, the same analysis that you just saw for all these countries. And the output is something like this. So here you've got the output for all the countries. So the first one is Andorra, very small country in Europe, probably never heard of it. This is how well my prediction fits. If this is one, I've got a perfect fit, which never happens. You can see that Andorra was already over its first wave, 114%. For example, the Arab Emirates at that point were only at 2/3 of their first wave, so they still had quite some people to go. The number of people in that wave, start date, the peak date, the floor date, so that's when the first outbreak was over in that country. And these are just the two parameters of the distribution that I calculated. So it's got two measures. The mu, which is the second one, just shows you where in time it happened. And the beta just shows you how steep the curve was. So from the beta number, you can also start deriving numbers like how well did we flatten the curve and stuff like that. So that's numbers that you can use in your next analysis. So what this notebook just basically does, it takes in the input data, runs the calculations for all the countries, and produces this output file that more or less looks like this. So it produces its own output CSV, which is called the progress file. And that's just what this notebook does. And that's also something that I use a lot, just a notebook that takes in a file from somewhere, downloads itself, does the calculation and produces an output, because then you can very easily use that notebook inside a pipeline of steps which all produce their own output and then eventually get to the results that you want to show to interested parties. So this produces an output again, which is picked up by the next data, by the next notebook, which will then process this output and start looking at other measures inside there. So here I read my own file again, just to check to see if everything went okay. So there's a lot of data that I calculate, and that's just basically the output of the notebook before. And then I found a data set. Oh, sorry. Then first I calculate this severity measure. So what you see here is a list of all the countries with high severity measures. So on top, for example, is Qatar. And I found out that a very good measure to compare countries would be the number of people relative to the total that were infectious at some point in the outbreak. So for Qatar, that number is pretty high. I take the logarithm of this number, so I use a log scale. So for example, -3 would mean that 1 in 1,000 people was infectious at the same time. -2 would mean 1 in 100. -4 would mean 1 in 10,000 people infectious at the same time. So that's basically what I'm calculating here and how I'm drawing the countries over here. So Qatar was the worst hit in the first wave. You see the US here somewhere. But yeah, that was just the New York outbreak. So compared to the whole of the US, that wasn't that severe, but still quite some people infectious at the same time. So here I derive this severity measure. Yeah, then I was looking for measures, by which I mean measures that were taken in the country to flatten the curve, basically, because that's what everybody was busy with in the first period. So I found this data file from ACAPS, which is an organization that just documents all these measures. They document a lot of health information worldwide. So I have a look at acaps.org. That's a very interesting data set, very interesting organization. And what they do is they publish this data set for all countries again. And by date, you can see for all those countries what kind of measures were being taken in that country. So was there a lockdown? Were there health measures? Was there some travel restrictions? All that kind of stuff can be found in the data set. And it's more or less similarly formatted as the file that we looked at before. So it basically just has the main columns are this country on this date took this kind of measure. That's basically, the three columns that we're looking at. So we already have a severity measure for the countries, which we just derived in the notebooks before. And I'm now going to try to relate that to actual government measures that were taken in the countries. So what I decided upon as a first try was the point in time that a measure was taken in the country. So for example, in the Netherlands, at some point in time, there was decided that we would have a kind of lockdown. And what I'm looking at is I calculate the start date of the outbreak for all these countries. I'm looking at the period in time of the lockdown related to this start. So did we already go into lockdown before it started or afterwards? And then how much afterwards? And did that have any influence on the way that the outbreak progressed? So that is basically what I'm trying to do here. So I find all these measures. There's two types of measures. So there's introductions and there's also phase out. So you could have a look at the period of the lockdown. And I'm trying to relate that to this severity measure. So a little bit of data wrangling on this data set to get it into the right format to get them together. And what I do basically here is I just merge these two data sets because they both have a three-letter ISO code. So it's pretty easy to get them together in one data set. So I calculate the difference between the implementation date here and the start date that I calculated myself. So did they take this measure early or late in the process, basically, is what's being calculated here. So I see here, for example, there were some measures taken in countries already 132 days before anything happened in that country. And there were also measures that were taken 118 days after something happened in the country. So there's quite some distribution there. So that might be interesting to look at in detail. So here I put it all together. So I've got this full data set, which has for every measure, the number of days relative to the start of the outbreak, and then the severity of the outbreak in the country to model upon. So here's just some checks on the data. So for example, this is a scatter plot between the lockdown date and the target, which is the severity, which I defined before. So you can see basically, if you half close your eyes, that there's some kind of relationship between how early you lock down and how severe your measure, your outbreak will be, but it's not that clear. So that's already a first indication of do lockdowns actually work and how do they work, basically, is what you could start seeing here. But then, yeah, as you do in data science, in data modeling, you just take all your inputs and you start, you don't look for all the relations yourself, but you try to get a list of interesting relations between data. So here are the relations between the measures themselves. So for example, you can see that the lockdown correlates quite high with all the other measures, which means basically that there is hardly any country that only took lockdown measures. There's always a lockdown on top of all kinds of other stuff, which already makes it pretty hard to say something about lockdowns in isolation, because you don't have any country that only had a lockdown. They're also always also related to other kinds of measures. So it's that might become pretty hard to say something about just lockdowns. Yeah, then I create a model. I won't go into all those details about modeling, but basically what you try to do in a data set like this, which has little data, only 200 countries, you try to make your model not overfit too much. And overfitting would just mean that the model describes every country in isolation, but is not very well generalizable. So you would never be able from this model to say something about a new outbreak. It will only describe the outbreaks that are already there. So you have to generalize quite well. And this is just a control graph. These numbers, these lines should almost be on top of each other to show if that is happening at all. So is this model generally usable or not? So this is the first output. If you train the model on that, which says, okay, public health measures, I'm not sure if you can read this, but this says public health measures, is the largest influencing factor. So taking early public measures helps you a lot in the severity of the lockdown. That is basically what it says. So here's governance and socioeconomic measures, like helping companies get through the crisis. Social distancing is here, and here is lockdown. So looking at this very naively, you could say, okay, but then lockdowns hardly work. But as I just explained, lockdowns are never in isolation. So this is only the additional effect of a lockdown on top of already of other measures already taken. Because social distancing is already a form of lockdown. So a lockdown on top of social distancing doesn't maybe not do much extra, but it does help. I mean, it does help in reducing the severity of the outbreak. So that's basically what you can see here. But this is just general stuff. And what it allows you, if you use an explainer model to try to explain what the model actually does, you can get some very nice nice insights. So I ran an explainer on this model for the Netherlands in this case. And you can see that the value for the Netherlands is -3.64, which is just which is way under 1 in 1,000 people infected at the same time, if you remember correctly. And here you can see why this number is as it is. So it's higher than average compared to other countries because we took our public health measures relatively late. It says 37.2 here. So only 37 days, so over a month after the start of the first outbreak, we really started taking serious public health measures, and that made our number higher than average. That's basically what this output tells you. There's also positive stuff. So for example, governance and socioeconomic measures, which is at over just over 10. So 10 days after the outbreak, we already started taking these socioeconomic measures, which is better than average, what this tells you. And it made our number lower than average. So this is something that helped us. So if you do that for the US, and again, I'm only looking at the first wave for the US. So this is just about the New York outbreak, basically. You can see a similar effect. The number was higher than expected because the public health measures were only taken almost 20 days after the start of the outbreak. There was no actual lockdown, no strict lockdown. It says not available here, which is also something that was not positive for the severity of the outbreak. And you can, for example, see that governance and economic measures were taken better than average and made the number lower than average. So you can very very well analyze how countries are behaving. So for example, this is Togo, a country in Africa, which did not have hardly had a first outbreak. It was very low, and you could see that it was under 1 in 10,000 people infectious at the same time, and that was just because they were very early in all their measures. So they basically said already 53 days before the outbreak, they already started taking public health measures 44 days before they started doing governance measures. So they were very early in their measures, and that helped their number get a lot lower. So yeah, if you run this for yourself, you can just drop in two-letter codes here and have a look at countries. So if you want to see your own country, ping me after the talk, and we can have a look together if you want to. Then there's also a summary graph, which one is one of the last ones I'll show you, which basically shows you the overall effect of the measures. So on the left are the countries with bad numbers, severe outbreaks. And you can see that they were late in public health measures, late in just about every measure that was taken. And you can see the other effects on the other side. But for example, you can see here that for the countries that were worse in their outbreaks, public health measures and governance measures were equally bad. While for the countries that were not that bad in their outbreaks, the main factor there was public health measures. That's the biggest effect of getting on the right side of the outbreak. So yeah, there's lots to explore, lots to see here. There's some effects that you can also see that taking a measure too early doesn't also help you very much. So this is called a bee swarm plot. So here are all the countries are bubbles in this plot, and here you see the measures. So you probably can't see it very well, but for social distancing here, you see this gray one here, basically, which means that if you don't take these social distancing measures, that will have a negative effect. But if you take them too early, which is the red part here, if you take them too early, they also work in a negative way. If you take them at the right time before, they work positively. If you take them too late, it's not very well. But if you take them really early, it is also counterproductive. And that's basically just human behavior, where you say, if you tell people to keep social distancing and nothing happens, there's no outbreak, no disease, they'll just start ignoring that measure. So that won't work in the way that you might expect it. So this is just, I guess, most of what I wanted to tell you today. Yeah, you already get the impression probably that there's indeed another 3 days that I can talk about this, but feel free to pick this stuff up for yourself. Have a look around and see what you can do just using a couple of simple lines of Python, to be honest, the right libraries, and the right approach to analyzing your data.